beautiful beaches, spicy somtam, swerving tuk-tuks, the hangover too. These are all things associated with Thailand, and after 2020, we can add one more thing to that list. Thailand was a place where COVID-19 didn't completely ruin 2020. Don't get me wrong, Thailand's response wasn't perfect, and there's certainly plenty to criticize. Take the slow vaccine rollout as just one example. But for the most part, kids went to school, people ate at restaurants, and life pretty much went on. To put things in perspective, I compare Thailand to other countries around the world, which have been imposing lockdowns and burying people in mass graves. And I realize Thailand wasn't a bad place to spend 2020. It wasn't even until April 2021, a full 14 months since SARS-CoV-2 was first detected in Thailand, that the country even saw any outbreak worth talking about. At its worst, there were about 2,000 cases and around 25 deaths per day. For any other country of nearly 70 million, this would be considered good news. Just look at the UK, France, and Germany, which all have populations close to Thailand's. All told, Thailand still has one of the lowest numbers of cases per capita in the world. And who knows, maybe by the time you're watching this video, things are worse. But Thailand's worst still seems to be better than most other countries' best. So the question that needs to be asked is, what is different about Thailand? Why has Thailand not ended up in the same situation as other countries? Or will the luck run out eventually? In today's video, I'll try to answer those questions, and I hope you might be surprised by some of the answers. This video is a follow-up to one I made all the way back in August 2020, so I've already given 5 reasons why Thailand is beating COVID, and for the most part, they're still true. If you saw that video, be sure to let me know in the comments, and thank you to everyone who watched that one and subscribed. If you haven't watched that video, be sure to check it out. I'll put a link at the end. Okay, so the question we need to answer today is, why is Thailand different? To answer that, I'm going to give you 5 more reasons why Thailand is still beating COVID-19, and I'll also talk about the cost that all of this has had on society. So here we go. Reason number 5, ventilation. One of the defining features of SARS-CoV-2 is its ability to transmit really well via small droplets that we make when we cough, talk, or sing. There are other ways for the virus to transmit, and they include direct contact, long-distance airborne transmission, fomite transfer, and fecal-oral. But it seems like the vast majority of infections come from inhaling droplets. What that means is that indoor spaces where the air is not well ventilated, especially if the area is crowded, are where most people get sick. Take this study from the US, for example. By looking at granular cell phone data from 98 million Americans, they found that nearly 80% of all infections came from only 10% of places, and full-service restaurants were the number one place where people got sick, places where people are indoors for long periods of time. And of course, if you're eating, you couldn't possibly be wearing a mask. It's why many in the scientific community are calling for more ventilation. What about Thailand, though? What's really different about Thailand from the US or Europe is the climate. It's hot year-round, so most buildings are not well sealed, if they have walls at all. People don't spend a lot of time in enclosed spaces, rebreathing the same stagnant air. In fact, only a few major clusters have been identified in Thailand to date. They include a Muay Thai boxing gym early in the pandemic, prisons, factories, and karaoke bars. They're all indoor spaces with large numbers of people sharing the same air. The open-air lifestyle in Thailand has certainly been a helpful factor. Reason number 4, limited but targeted testing. After my first video, I got a few comments from people dismissing Thailand's low case count, saying, it's because they aren't testing. And if we compare sheer numbers of tests, that may appear true. As of May 2, 2021, Thailand has conducted more than 8 million tests. That's about one test for every 10 people. Compare that to Denmark, Luxembourg, or the UAE, where they have actually conducted 4 times as many tests as there are number of people in the population. Many other countries, including the US, UK, and nearby Singapore, have also reported conducting more tests than number of people. But, as demonstrated in Thailand, it's not about how many tests you've performed. Back in March 2020, Thailand bucked the global trend by not implementing a mass testing program open to anyone who requested it. At that time, testing was tightly restricted to only people who met a certain set of criteria. This was widely criticized at the time, and I was even one of those vocal critics of this decision then, publishing critical articles. However, in retrospect, Thailand made the smart decision to save its limited testing resources for the most important cases. In doing so, it stayed ahead of the virus and eventually stopped domestic transmission for most of the year. Rather than the number of tests, it's who you're testing that's important. In Thailand's targeted approach, testing is prioritized for people known to have been in contact with an existing case. Extensive contact tracing is done using apps, publicizing information, and health personnel, such as the VHVs I talked about in the first video. If you do this fast enough, you can stay ahead of the virus. By another metric, though, Thailand is actually testing a lot. The test positivity rate, which is the percentage of tests that are returned positive, is still very low here. This is a sign that Thailand is actually testing enough. Only a few countries have a lower test positivity rate, including Vietnam, New Zealand, and Hong Kong, each at 0.1%. Compare that to the US or Italy, where it is 10 times higher at 7 or 8%. Or in Brazil, where the test positivity rate is a shocking 50%. Reason number 3, pre-existing cross immunity. It's true that Thailand has done some things right, and it has a respected health system. But we could say the same thing about a lot of other countries. There must be something more. I'm being a bit speculative here, but one possibility is pre-existing cross immunity. Studies have not yet looked at whether Thailand or other Southeast Asian countries have some existing immunity that has dampened transmission of SARS-CoV-2, but we know it's theoretically possible. A study published in November documented immune cross-reactivity from seasonal coronaviruses. What they found was that basically, some people who had been recently infected with other human coronaviruses, the ones we're familiar with that cause a cold, had some existing antibodies that were cross-reactive to the SARS-CoV-2 virus. In other words, their immune system was able to respond quickly to the novel coronavirus, preventing a runaway infection and limiting transmission. Multiple independent assays demonstrate the presence of pre-existing antibodies recognizing SARS-CoV-2 in uninfected individuals, they reported. They conclude that prior immunity induced by one coronavirus can reduce the transmission of similar coronaviruses and ameliorate the symptoms when transmission is not prevented. In this study, these findings were particularly true in young people. They surmised it was probably due to the fact that children and adolescents generally have higher coronavirus infection rates and a more diverse antibody repertoire. So it's reasonable to assume that Thailand and other Southeast Asian countries may be like the children of the world in that we have had higher infection rates of other coronaviruses and a more diverse antibody repertoire. Reason number 2, high vaccination rates. Thailand has really high vaccination rates. Now, I don't mean COVID vaccines. What I'm talking about are the vaccines that have been around for years. For common vaccine-preventable diseases like diphtheria, tetanus, polio, measles, rubella, and hepatitis, Thailand has virtually 100% vaccination rates. This is attributed to strong primary healthcare and the healthcare delivery systems. But what is perhaps most important is the fact that Thailand also has nearly 100% vaccination rates for the BCG vaccine against tuberculosis, or TB. TB is still endemic to Thailand, and Thailand still has TB wards in hospitals. This is why Thailand continues to use the BCG vaccine, while many countries in North America and Europe stopped widespread BCG vaccination as long as several decades ago. Early in the pandemic, it was first observed that there seemed to be a correlation between a country giving BCG vaccinations and those countries having less COVID cases. For example, this one that showed a strong correlation between increased BCG vaccination rates and reduced COVID deaths. At first, I dismissed this as probably a coincidental correlation caused by some confounding factor. I figured once the virus became more widespread, this correlation would weaken. And in fact, a recent study found just that. After adjusting for age, response, and other factors, they found that countries with a policy for BCG vaccination fared no better in SARS-CoV-2 mortality and morbidity. But on the other hand, there is theoretical support for a mechanism as to why BCG would prevent some infections from SARS-CoV-2. We know that live attenuated vaccine strains of the BCG vaccine induces potent and non-specific protection against other non-related diseases. It basically acts like a booster for your immune system. And in fact, a cohort study of healthcare workers found that those with a history of BCG vaccination were less likely to get infected with COVID and less likely to have a severe infection. So this reason, I will admit, is a bit speculative, but it's possible that it's no coincidence that Thailand universally vaccinates for BCG and has had low transmission rates for the coronavirus. Finally, reason number one, strict border controls. Thailand closed its borders back in late March and basically kept them shut for the rest of 2020 and into 2021. A country that saw 85 million international arrivals in 2019 has virtually shut down to a handful of chartered and semi-commercial flights arriving each day. To come to Thailand requires a traveler to request permission from the Thai embassy in their country, get tested, purchase health insurance, and prearrange an approved quarantine hotel for 2 weeks. Thai citizens can stay at a quarantine facility for free, but non-Thai citizens must pay out of pocket with a typical starting price of $2,000 for the 14-night stay, receiving at least 2 COVID tests during that time. The border controls haven't been flawless, though. The holes in this plan were revealed in late November and early December as several young Thai women returned by cover of night across the border with Burma. They were there to offer their entertainment services to gentlemen at the nightclub in the neighboring Burmese city where apparently a huge outbreak of coronavirus was occurring. Because these women didn't pass through a legal border control point, they didn't enter quarantine and ended up passing along a few local transmissions. And more recently, the so-called UK variant, more formally known as B117, found its way into Thailand. In fact, it has been driving the April 2021 outbreak. Reports have again blamed illegal border crossers, this time Cambodia. In any case, by essentially closing the borders, Thailand significantly delayed the introduction of the variants that have proven troublesome for the rest of the world. Now, my point here is not that Thailand will never have any outbreaks or even that the Thai government has done a good job. My point is that relative to the rest of the world, Thailand is among a handful of countries that have not suffered severely as a result of COVID. And I tried to find some reasons to explain that. Admittedly, some of this is luck, and that luck may run out someday. Let me know what you think in the comments. Before we go, though, all of this has not come without a cost. Serious economic and social consequences have come as a result of Thailand's COVID-19 policies. It's estimated that 65% of Thailand's workforce has seen their income decline. The national economy will shrink by 8% in 2020. Suicides increased by 22% in the first 6 months of 2020. Much of these effects have been driven by the devastating disappearance of the tourism industry, which normally accounts for nearly one-fifth of national GDP. Now, it's hard to say what proportion of these economic effects were really preventable and how much is related to the overall slowdown in the global economy. But it's safe to say that despite Thailand's immunity from the effects of the virus, it has not been spared the economic hit. So there you have it, 5 more reasons why Thailand is still winning when it comes to COVID-19. Altogether, all 10 of the reasons I've shared contribute in some way, and we can't pin the outcome on any singular factor. Let me know which one you think has made the most difference in the comments below. And check out some of these other videos. And as always, thanks for watching.